Hello and welcome back to our robotics series. In the last video, we set up this Raspberry Pi Zero W, and the W stands for wireless because we need to connect to the internet. We want you guys to send in tweets to tell the robot where to go. You're going to be able to tell it to go forwards, backwards, left, or right. And this board is going to be great at parsing out the text from your tweets, but it's not really suited for controlling any motors. So we need a second board for that, and we already had this Adafruit Motor Controller board, so this is the one that we're going to use. It has four terminal blocks on the outside, and that can either drive two stepper motors or four DC motors. And you might have seen robots already on the internet that use two DC motors and then a ball wheel, but we already have four DC motors lying around, so we decided why not use all of them. So in this video, I want to go over why we need this board, what are the chips on it, what do we do with it, and how do we code it. And all the code that you're going to see in this video is going to be in the hackster.io project that's linked down in the description below. So all the libraries we're installing here and the code that we're going to put on here to actually run this will be in that project, and you can just copy and paste it. But let's go see what we want our motors to do and how to actually get them to do that. This is a DC motor. It's a lot larger than the one we're going to put on our robot, but let's just look at the ways that we can control it. So if I put the switch in the downward position, then we see we have a voltage of about 1.8. And I can change this voltage by moving this potentiometer right here. And as we're increasing our voltage, we're also increasing our speed that our motor is driving at. But if I go into the upper position, then we can see that there is a negative right here. So we are at about negative 3.8 volts. And we're spinning in the opposite direction. So increasing and decreasing the voltage is going to change the speed of our motor, and the direction of current is going to change whether we're going clockwise or counterclockwise. And those are two ways that we can manipulate motors. However, I don't want to personally read all your tweets and switch these buttons back and forth and play with this potentiometer, so we're going to need a digital solution for this. This motor controller board is our digital solution, and it has three chips on it, but these two are exactly the same, and I wanted to look them up to see what our board was doing. So these ones on the outside have this part number right here. And I looked up the data sheet, and this is a simplified block drawing of what was in there. But let's look at the output side first because it's easiest. So all we would do is hook up our motor, our power and ground, to either the A outputs or the B outputs. And we can either change the voltage that's going to it or the direction of the current. And the way we do that is with these over here. We have the voltage in for our motor, we have the ground, and then each of these has three different things we can change, either a PWM, an input one, or an input two. And this is for the second motor down here. So let's see what these three inputs do. PWM stands for pulse width modulation, and it's how we control the speed of our motor. We have a voltage over time graph right here, and this is our maximum voltage, and this is our minimum voltage. When we're talking about digital, we either have a low or a high. And when we want to change that into an analog signal, what we have to do is vary the time between these pulses right here. So if we never had a gap between the high pulses all the way across here, we have full power. Our motor's going full tilt forward. But if we had it zero, then we're either braking or we turned off the motor. Depending on the length of time between the pulses is how fast your motor is going to go. For a slower speed, there's a longer time in between the pulses, and for a higher speed, there's shorter time between the pulses, and that's how we're changing the speed. But how do we change the direction? For that, we're going to use an H-bridge, and this is a very simplified version of the H-bridge. It's missing a lot of components, but for the basic idea of how it works, we'll just look at it with four switches, and this M in the middle is for our motor. So we have a voltage in right here, this is our motor voltage, and a ground. And right now, the switches are all open, which means we have an open circuit and nothing is going through. So we have to close some parts of this. And if we closed A in one, which was one of our inputs we had up in our chip select, if we close this switch, this one will also close. So the voltage will come in here, it will go down this path, it will go across the motor in this direction, and then down and out through ground, because we've completed our circuit. This one and this one are still open. And then if we want the direction of the current to go the opposite way, we close A in two. So we're setting this to high, we're closing this switch, and this switch will also close. So we go down and we're going across the motor in the opposite direction. And that's how we control the inputs. And then for the outputs, if we had closed this side and it comes down, this output is high and this one is low. It's on the ground side. And if we come down and we go the opposite direction, this output is high and this output is low. So when we're going back up to our diagram right here, these are the outs right here. So we decide if this is high or if this one is high, and that's gonna decide the direction over here on our outputs. Each of these chips have two full H-bridge circuits, which means they're capable of controlling two motors and telling them what direction they should be going in and how fast they should be going. So why do we even need this third chip? And the reason is this is a feather board. So this is the exact same kind of board, just with the header pins installed, and you can see they both go up and down. And that's because it's meant to be stacked with another board. So there are bottom boards that have these ARM chips right here, and they're able to be programmed over USB, and they have external power over here. So we are supposed to put one of these on top of the board below. And this bottom board is going to provide logic power for the chips, so 3.3 volts to the chip above and a ground, and it's going to communicate with it over I2C. And these chips on the end do not have the capability of talking over I2C. So this third one, this PCA9685, is an I2C PWM controller. So how do we deal with this board and the Raspberry Pi? The Raspberry Pi also has I2C. So we're going to be able to provide the 3.3 logic to the chips from the Pi and a ground. And we're going to talk over I2C, which is an SDA, which is the data line and our clock line right there. So that's going to be able to talk to this board. The outputs for this chip right here are all PWM, and that's because this is really an LED controller, not a motor controller. It's only rated for up to 5.5 volts. And if we flip this over, remember, we could go up to 12 volts with our motor. And that's why these chips are actually driving the motors. These PWM outputs are mapped to the inputs for our TB chips. It's either going to be a pulse width modulation that controls the speed, or it's going to be this riding high full power that turns on a switch, or it's going to be a low power PWM for the opposite one, so you're keeping it closed. So that's how these PWM outputs are controlling these two chips right here. And they're really the ones that are driving the motors. Let's overview how the chips communicate with each other, and we're only going to look at motor one. So the first thing that happens is the Raspberry Pi is going to talk to the upper chip using I2C, and it's going to control PWM2, 3, and 4. PWM2, if we drove that high, that's going to mean our motor is running at the maximum voltage and it's going to be going full speed. If we drive that too low, then our motor is going to turn off. If we have any frequency of pulses, we're going to be somewhere between 100% power and 0% power. To change our direction, we're going to use our H-bridge circuit, and we can use PWM4 and PWM3 to control the switches inside the circuit. PWM4 can close switch A1 in if it rides high, and then we would set A2 in to low. This way, only one half of the circuit is completed, and the wheel is going to start rotating in one of the directions. It means that A10 is high and A02 is low, and we can switch and do the exact opposite. You can have PWM3 drive A in too high, and we have PWM4 set A in to low, and the opposite side of the circuit is completed. And now A02 is high and A01 is low, and this changes the direction that our motor is spinning. Now that we know how the chips on our board work, we can move on to coding. The libraries for this chip are written in CircuitPython, and we're writing our code in Python. So what are the differences between the two? Well, CircuitPython is a special flavor of MicroPython written by Adafruit. And MicroPython was written by somebody that wanted to use Python on microcontrollers and embedded systems. Usually when we've coded in the past, we've used the Arduino IDE, and that's C code that gets compiled and the machine code gets sent down to the chip on the board. And that's pretty efficient. And Python itself would be highly inefficient on any of these boards. But you can run it on a Raspberry Pi because it's pretty much just a miniature computer. So MicroPython strips out some of the libraries from regular Python 3, but leaves you a lot of the same functionality and features. And it's written to be more efficient on the boards and to talk with the different parts of hardware. And that's why CircuitPython has a bunch of libraries like this that have bus.io that are going to talk to your hardware in a certain way when you're talking over I2C or to certain registers or to your digital input and output pins. So we need to install some libraries that are going to be able to translate between Python and CircuitPython so your hardware knows what it should be doing. First, we want to make sure that our software is up to date on a Raspberry Pi, and then we're going to install tools for pip3. Pip is a way to install libraries onto your Raspberry Pi, and pip3 means we're using Python 3. And that's the version of Python that works with CircuitPython and MicroPython. If you ever have problems installing libraries, you just do sudo pip3. The first library we're going to install is the Blinka library, and this is going to be the translation piece between CircuitPython libraries and the code that you're writing. Blinka automatically installs all of these. If you haven't done it already, you should install the Raspberry Pi gpio library. And then we need to install these three CircuitPython libraries. This PCA one is the one that talks to the PWM controller. The motor library helps this library talk to these two chips on the side, the TB chips. And then the motor kit library is just going to make it a lot easier for us to write the code. When we install that, this is all the code you have to write. Use import time in case you want to sleep between your motor commands. And then you import the motor kit, and then you make a class and assign it to kit, and you just do kit dot motor, and it could be motor 1, 2, 3, or 4 dot throttle, and then you give it a value between 1 and -1. So 1 is full power forward and -1 is full power reverse. And if you wanted to break, you'd be 0, or half power would be 0.5, and so on. I hooked up a motor to port 1 and ran it, and it seemed to go perfectly. And in one of our next videos, we're going to add encoders to it so we know how many rotations that our motors are making. And then we're going to put all of it onto our 3D printed chassis and see if we can start getting it to drive around. Thank you guys so much for learning with me today. If you have any questions or comments, you can leave them below. And if you want any of the code that we used today, it's in our hackster.io project down in the description. And I will see you next time.